Each rocket was custom-built for one launch only, then discarded in pieces as its cargo climbed into orbit. NASA needed to reduce costs due to budget cuts in the 1970s. Their answer was the Space Shuttle, a reusable, small, light vehicle that could land like a plane. Then, to secure additional funding, NASA adapted the design for the Air Force and built a machine capable of carrying satellites. This meant a larger payload bay, larger wings, and a heavier craft. When it first launched in 1981, the shuttle was a technological marvel. But the final design was no longer the vehicle NASA originally wanted, nor was it as safe as they had originally planned. The increased size requires the shuttle to be positioned alongside the solid rocket boosters instead of above. Now, if the rockets exploded, the shuttle itself risked being caught in the fireball. NASA promised a machine that would make spaceflight routine. By 1985, they are struggling just to keep the machine in service. The public watches in awe, unaware of the potential for disaster. In the aftermath of the Challenger explosion, a presidential commission is set up to find out exactly what went wrong. Its chairman is William Rogers, Secretary of State under Richard Nixon. The Rogers Commission has a dazzling array of members: scientists, politicians, astronauts, and military officers. The commission also picks one of the most brilliant minds in America, someone with no connections to the space industry, who can bring a different perspective: Richard Feynman.
Different aspects of nature are really different aspects of the same thing. That all the phenomena that you see, the great variety of different things, can all be explained, perhaps, as different aspects of some underlying business, or some underlying laws, or some underlying simplicity.
Richard Feynman was involved in the development of the atom bomb and won the Nobel Prize for Physics. He's known as a free thinker, an intellectual maverick, a genius with a sharp sense of humor and a love of bongo drums. He's also undergoing treatment for cancer.
Hello? I've told you, Bill. I've spent a lifetime avoiding Washington, so right now my answer would have to be no thanks. I'll consider what you said, but I really do think you should approach somebody else. Goodbye.
There you go. Who was that?
Do you remember an old student of mine, Bill Graham?
No.
Well, apparently he's now the deputy administrator for NASA.
What did he want?
He wants me to serve on this presidential commission that's investigating the Challenger accident.
What did you say?
I said no. I've spent a lifetime avoiding Washington. I'm too old to get mixed up with the political shenanigans that go on in that place.
I think you should do it.
Oh, well, there's plenty of others just as qualified.
There may not be anything, but if there is, you'll find it. There isn't anyone else who can do that like you can.
I see you're appealing to my vanity.
It usually works.
Any idea what caused the accident, Professor?
Oh, there are all sorts of ideas flying around. I wouldn't like to speculate.
What do you think you can bring to this inquiry?
Well, in science, sometimes you get a better understanding of a problem by looking at it from a different angle. Maybe that's what I bring, a different angle.
Ed, what do you say to those people who are convinced that this commission will be a cover-up?
Listen, I was talking to a bunch of rocket engineers the other day, and they were discussing a certain problem. Now, they described this problem as being a pressure-induced vorticity oscillation.
I said, do you mean a whistle? They said, yeah, a whistle.
It's not the cover-up we have to fear. It's the truth obscured by arcane language. Or maybe that's where I bring an edge. I'm not bamboozled by the language of science.
Ladies and gentlemen, I now would like to call this first meeting of the Presidential Commission on the Space Shuttle Challenger accident to order. I want to start with just a couple of preliminary remarks. As you know,
NASA presents the commission with various possible reasons for the shuttle failure. Early on in the hearing, the commission's attention turns to the solid rocket boosters. From the start, it's plain to Feynman that the commission is getting bogged down in technical jargon. As a physicist, he knows there's always a simple answer. Roger Beaujolais is one of the engineers called to the hearings to explain how the solid rocket boosters operate. According to Beaujolais, Morton Thiokol's lawyers have told him to answer questions, but to not offer any extra information. He decides not to be silenced.
My name is Roger Beaujolais, and I'm in the structures section. And I've been involved with these seals and the rings basically since coming to Thiokol some 5.5 years ago.
NASA and Morton Thiokol already suspect that the solid rocket boosters are somehow to blame. Beaujolais tells the commission he knew a year ago that the O-rings in the solid rocket boosters can fail under some circumstances, and that if the primary and backup O-rings both fail, the whole launch system could explode. It's a revelation to the commission, but in hindsight, it is no surprise. The O-ring joints are there because the rocket boosters are built in segments. During the bidding process, some companies submitted designs for a single tube rocket booster, which could have been delivered by sea in one piece. But Morton Thiokol, who won the contract, is in Utah, a landlocked state. They have to transport the solid rocket booster segments to Florida by rail, where they are assembled for each launch. Making the rocket booster in segments creates its weakest link. The joints have to be gas tight. If any of the seals leak, superheated rocket exhaust will escape, potentially causing a catastrophic explosion.
This problem has escalated so badly in the eyes of everyone, especially our customer, NASA, that if we do not secure a timely solution, we stand in danger of having our competitors solve our problem.
Throughout the spring of 1985, Beaujolais struggles to get Morton Thiokol management to take his O-ring seal concerns seriously.
It was like I was talking to a solid piece of granite. No response, no reaction, no emotion, no anything. We all knew that the joint was defective, and we had no choice but to fly because that's what the managers insisted on. And so it was our job to keep it flying as safe as possible, but we didn't take that lightly.
If Beaujolais is right, it will only be a matter of time before something will fail. Each shuttle is engineered with a precision that